And the speaker is Neeraj Kayal from Microsoft Research in India, I think. And he will look for something hard again. Let's see how hard it will be.
thank you. Thank you for staying back for this last talk. I want to talk about a problem that I've been working on for quite a few years now, trying to find a polynomial which is hard to compute. So the objects of interest in this talk will be polynomials over a field, multivariate polynomials of degree D in n variables. And for concreteness, you can think of the underlying field as the complex numbers. And typically, n and d will be comparable. And if you just for concreteness, you can think of the number of variables as roughly d square, if I don't mention how they relate. And the question is, how many steps are required to compute a given polynomial f? So let me make this precise, the number of steps required to compute. It's the natural thing, the number of arithmetic operations required to do this. But let me formally define it. So we formally define this notion via an arithmetic circuit. You start with it, your inputs, x1, x2 through xn, the variables of the polynomial. And you do arithmetic operations. Each arithmetic operation is a basic step of your algorithm. So you could add two numbers. You could subtract two numbers. I will represent subtraction by, in fact, an addition gate where one of the edges has minus one. More generally, I will allow arbitrary constants on the edges going into an addition gate so that my addition gates, in fact, can compute linear combinations of the inputs. So for example, 2x2 plus 3x3 is all that is what can be also done by addition gates. And then multiplication and so on. And finally, you want to compute the polynomial f. The number of steps is the number of edges in this graph. And we will also care about the depth of the circuit, which is the longest path from an input node to the output. And the significance of depth is that it captures the amount of parallelization in the computation. If the circuit is very shallow, you get your answer very fast. Yes.
Levels in feeding inputs. I compare this to a wiring diagram.
Yes, you are allowed to skip levels, but yeah.
Thank
you. So now this is a fact that we know from the time of Shannon in 1950, that most polynomials are extremely hard to compute, just like for Boolean functions. And it's essentially the same argument. Over infinite fields, you have to modify it a little bit. But extremely here is essentially comparable to the number of monomials. What we would want is an explicit polynomial that is ideally extremely hard to compute, but we'll be happy even with a moderately hard to compute polynomial, something which requires super-polynomial in n number of steps. So let me define what we mean by an explicit polynomial. It's a polynomial such that the coefficient of any given monomial can be computed efficiently. So let me give some examples. The majority, you have an input of length n, you go over all subsets of size n over 2 and take the product of the variables in the subset. The property that is important for us, why we call it majority, is that if the inputs were Boolean input, then the output would be 0 if the number of ones in the input was less than 2, n over 2, and more than zero otherwise. This is very easy to verify. Let me tell you about another polynomial which syntactically looks similar, the clique polynomial. Here, the input represents a graph in the following sense. You take a m vertex graph, and n is the number of edges. And for each edge in this graph, label it with a variable xij, and the intention being that it will be 1 if the edge is present, 0 if the edge is absent. So now, it's very simple to, there's an almost obvious way to capture cliques in the graph, cliques of size m over 2, by the following polynomial. You go over all subsets of size m over 2, all subsets of vertices of size m over 2, and take the product of all the edges in that subset. So this term here will, for a fixed subset, this term will be 1 if that subset forms a clique, and it will be 0 otherwise. And so you have, again, this easy fact that if the xij's were, in fact, Boolean inputs, then this function will be 0 if the graph has no clique, and the last part is cut off, but it will be more than 0 otherwise. In fact, it will be the number of cliques. Let me give a few more examples. The determinant of a d by d matrix, so here the number of variables is d square. The determinant we are all familiar with, it's useful for doing linear algebra. And another polynomial which looks very similar to the determinant, except that in front of every monomial in the determinant, the sign is either plus 1 or minus 1, depending on whether it's an even permutation or an odd permutation. It looks simpler in the sense that the sign is plus 1 in front of every monomial here. Oh, and it's over the same set of monomials. Now, here's a couple of easy facts. Majority is easy to compute. Determinant, we also know, is easy to compute, essentially via Gaussian elimination. But the two other polynomials, which somehow syntactically they look very similar, but we believe that they are extremely hard to compute. We don't know how to prove that. We would be happy, in fact, in proving that they are even moderately hard to compute, super-polynomially hard to compute. This problem goes by the name of VP versus VNP. It's, in some sense, the arithmetic analog of P versus NP, but actually, morally, it's closer to sharp P versus TC1. VNP is morally more like sharp P, and VP is morally more like TC1, but never mind. It's some separation among complexity classes that we are trying to prove here. So let me step back a little bit and tell you about another thread of research on parallelizing computation. Here the question is, can we efficiently parallelize computation? Quantitatively, suppose that I have a computation that can be done in S steps. But now I want to parallelize it, so I want a circuit of depth delta which does the same computation. And the question is, now you can always do this. In fact, for delta equal to 2, with a depth 2 circuit, you write a polynomial as a sum of monomials, so you can always compute a polynomial with very small depth circuits, as small as depth 2. But the question is, what is the price that we must pay in terms of the size of this new circuit for doing the same computation? So here we know much more, and to illustrate the result that's going to come in the next few slides, let me take the example of one more polynomial, the iterated matrix multiplication. So here, you take D matrices, X1 through XD. The entries of these D matrices are again formal variables or generic numbers, Xijs. You want to multiply all these matrices and take the trace so that you just get one polynomial instead of a bunch of polynomials. And there's an easy way to do this. And now you want to, suppose you want to parallelize this computation. In this particular case, there's a very obvious way to parallelize this computation. So what we are going to do is that we'll compute all the entries of the product of the of these matrices. Then we are just going to take the sum of the diagonal elements that will give me the trace, the IMM polynomial. Now, when you want to compute the product, there's an obvious way to do it using the associativity of matrix multiplication. You divide your sequence of matrices into chunks of size t, where t is a parameter that you choose appropriately. Do a brute force multiplication of these t matrices and recurse with delta, recurse this for delta over two steps. This this star here is a sort of a brute force way of computing the entries of this matrix, in the sense that you write all these polynomials here as sums of monomials. And now, if you just choose your parameter t in the optimal way, this is the optimal setting, d to the 2 over delta. Delta is the depth that you want. Then you get a circuit of size n to the d to the 2 over delta. Now, the remarkable result, which started from the work of Hayafel, then Valiant, Skyam, Berkowitz, and then a series of works after that, is that any arithmetic computation, you can sort of qualitatively, you can do the same thing for any arithmetic computation, any circuit. So if you have a circuit of size S, which computes a polynomial of degree D, then you can do the same computation by a circuit of depth delta, and the price that you will pay in terms of the size is the same, is qualitatively similar to what you would pay for iterated matrix multiplication. In fact, in some sense, very roughly, the proof shows that any arithmetic computation you can reduce to matrix multiplication in some way. So, and we'll come back to this, whether this depth reduction is optimal or not. Now, this depth reduction also opens up a potential approach to attacking the VP versus VNP problem, and that's what I'm going to talk about. So, here, you can choose a suitable value of delta, and I will choose the depth to be 4. So what we'll do is we'll reduce any computation to a depth 4 computation. What it will do is it will make the computation easier to analyze, and hopefully that might help us prove lower bounds. So here is what I want to do. I have a polynomial in n variables. I want to prove that it is hard to compute. So So I proceed by contraposition, that it does not hold. So suppose it's easy to compute. Now I apply the depth reduction, and I can write my f as a sum of polynomials, a few polynomials, each of which is a product of low degree polynomials. And I will quantify this. Low degree here is, if I choose my depth to be 4, the low degree, the degrees that I'll get will be square root d, and the number of terms will be n to the square root d. And what we hope to prove is that this is impossible for the polynomials that I think are hard. What we have is a theorem which seems to come very close to this. So we can give I can give you an explicit polynomial f, a family of polynomials f, with the degree being with the number of variables being square of the degree, such that when you write it as a sum of product of polynomials of degree root d, the number of terms that you require is n to the root d. Now, this seems to come close, because if we could beat this n to the root d here, if we could get something better than root d in the exponent, we would have solved the VP versus VNP problem, because from the first fact. Currently, we don't know how to do this. So in the rest of this talk, what I want to give you is a flavor of this proof. And there's a paradigm which underlies this proof. And I want to understand whether this paradigm can be instantiated with in more sophisticated ways to improve this lower bound or not. So how does the proof go? So suppose I have a candidate hard polynomial f. I want to show that when you write it as a sum of product of low degree polynomials, the number of summands that you require is very large. Then here's the rough outline of the proof. I associate a matrix M of G to every polynomial G, such that this association satisfies the following properties. First of all, the rank of the matrix associated to any one term Ti here is small. So the matrix corresponding to products of low degree polynomials should be small. This should be a linear map from polynomials to matrices. So if I take a linear combination of any two polynomials, I should get that linear combination of matrices. And the rank of my candidate hard polynomial, the rank of the matrix corresponding to my candidate hard polynomial is large. So suppose you have such matrices, then it's clear that you'll get a lower bound on the number of terms S. Because for each term, the rank is small, so you'd have to add up a large number of them in order to match the rank on the left-hand side. And how many of them? It will be the ratio of what this large number is to what this small number is. This ratio is the lower bound on the number of terms. So it turns out that almost all the proofs that we know follow this template. But what we'll do in trying to find these matrices is we'll do it via looking at geometric properties of these of certain varieties. So here's what we'll do. Each of these terms, it's a polynomial, and they define a variety. So variety is just a set of points at which the polynomial vanishes. I'll define it formally in a moment. So we'll sort of examine properties of this variety and then try to convert this property into rank of some matrix. And then finally, we'll show that rank of the matrix for my hard function is large. So let me just define variety. It's just all points in the algebraic closure of the field that you are working on at which the polynomial vanishes. So typically, I will work with algebraically closed fields. It should be the closure of F if the underlying field is F. So here's a example variety in three dimensions. So, okay. Now I will implement this strategy for the theorem that I'd shown you. So let me first tell you about the last step. This turns out to be the easiest, so let me just deal with this first. Typically, the matrices that we'll get here will be extremely huge, and it's non-trivial to analyze the rank of these matrices, but there are two simple, very extremely simple properties which help us do this analysis. The first is that if I have a matrix M which contains a submatrix that is upper triangular with non-zero entries on the diagonal, then the size of this upper triangular submatrix is a lower bound on the rank of the matrix. It's almost obvious because upper triangular matrix has a full rank. Another fact is that now suppose if the columns of my matrix were orthogonal, then my matrix would have full rank. There's an approximate version of this due to Noga-Allon that if the columns of M are almost orthogonal, then my matrix has large rank. And let me not go too much into the details of it, but it's a wonderful lemma. The proof is just two or three lines, but it's amazing how powerful it is. And there's a very diverse array of situations where it is used. And that essentially helps us prove the last step. Now, the more interesting parts of this proof are the following. Trying to find interesting geometric properties of these varieties. So, in my case, each term here, Ti, is a product of low-degree polynomials. So, if I just translate this fact into geometry, it means that this variety is a union of low-degree hypersurfaces. So far, this is a very straightforward translation. If you have a product of polynomials and it vanishes at a point, then one of the factors must vanish at that point. So this is easy. And this will imply that the variety has lots of high-order singularities. And I'll explain this by a picture in a moment. I seem to be missing the picture, but suppose imagine you have two curves in the plane, for example. Then if you pick two random curves in the plane, they will intersect at a bunch of points. So in particular, if you have two curves of degree d in the plane, they will intersect at about d square points. All these points of intersection are singularities of the product polynomial. So think of t as being g times h, then the common roots of g and h, and there will be quite a few of them, they are singularities of t, meaning that the derivatives of t also vanish at these points of intersection. And because we are intersecting varieties, if we intersect only a few of them, the resulting intersection will also have large dimension. So there will be lots of points of intersection and therefore lots of singularities. So this is the geometric property that I want to exploit. Now, now comes the most interesting part, to convert geometric properties into ranks of matrices. And the idea for this was actually there in the work of Hilbert from the 19th century. So let me give some sort of caricature of Hilbert's observations. So suppose you have a variety V defined by a bunch of polynomials, F1 through Fm. So it's the zero set of this set of polynomials. Now, let GL be the set of degree L polynomials. And let GLV be the set of degree L polynomials which vanish at all points on V. Now, intuitively, if V is a large set, contains lots of points, now then each point is imposing a constraint on my polynomial in GLV. So L here is a parameter, and finally L will be something like poly N. So this GL is a vector space. In fact, you are taking all polynomials of degree L. It forms a vector space. So now think of it like this, that each time you ask my polynomial to vanish at a particular point, you are imposing a linear constraint on the coefficients defining coefficient of a polynomial in GL. So intuitively, each point is reducing the dimensionality of GLV. So if V is large, GLV should be small. And that's the informal version of Hilbert's theorem. But in practice, we don't actually have the variety to work with. We only have these polynomials. So in practice, we can't work with GLV. We work with a proxy for GLV. And this is the ideal. So let me define the set ILV to be the set of all polynomials of the form a1 f1 plus a2 f2 plus am fm. These ais, they are polynomials, not constants. They are polynomials over the underlying field, and their degrees are such that the degrees of this linear combination is always bounded by L. So for example, if all the FIs have degree D, I want to take my AIs to have degree L minus D, so that any product here, AI FI, will have degree L, bounded by L. So in some sense, this ILV is a proxy for GLV, in the sense that It's a subset of GLV because if you have a point, say, alpha, which is a common zero of all the FIs, then it's also a zero of any polynomial in this set ILV. Because if FI of alpha is zero for all I, then any linear combination also vanishes at alpha. So what Hilbert showed was that if V is large, the variety is large, in the sense that it has high dimension, dimension some number r, then ILV is small in the in an asymptotic sense that its dimension as a vector space is the maximum possible minus something which asymptotically grows like L to the R. That was good enough for the purpose of Hilbert, so essentially we use this. So by the way, this also gives us a map from sets of polynomials to matrices, because if you think about it, you can take a vector space basis of this set of polynomials ILV, arrange them as the rows of a matrix. So think of each possible basis polynomial as a vector, arrange them as the rows of a matrix, and the dimension of this vector space is the rank of the matrix. So this is essentially what gives us the matrix that we are looking for. But there's one thing where we differ from Hilbert. These asymptotic estimates are not good enough for us. We have very specific and very small values of L that we need for our lower bound. And we need to, so this theorem of Hilbert is some sort of asymptotic upper bound, but we need much more concrete upper bounds for the kind of application that we have in mind. And that can be done. And that essentially gives us the proof of the theorem. So just to summarize that we have, we can prove bounds like this, that I can give you explicit polynomials such that if you write them as a sum of product of low degree polynomials, then the number of summands will be large. And the question was whether this can in fact give you something better, in which case it would prove the VP versus VNP conjecture. But there was a follow-up work by Fournier, Limaye, Malod, and Srinivasan, and Kumar and Saraf, who showed very roughly, there's some different choice of parameters, but essentially the same thing works for the iterated matrix multiplication polynomial, which we know is easy to compute. So on the one hand, this is bad news. It seems to indicate that this technique won't work, won't lead to any improvement here, cannot resolve VP versus VNP. But on the positive side, it answers another question of how to efficiently parallelize computation. So recall that I told you that you can take any computation of size S and do the same computation using a depth 4 circuit of size S to the root D, and it degrades the size required goes down as you allow me higher depth. With some caveats, this result also implies that this depth reduction is essentially optimal. That's the best possible trade-off that you can obtain. The caveat being that the kind of circuits that you get should be regular and homogeneous. The intermediate polynomials should all consist of homogeneous polynomials. And all the nodes at a particular layer in the circuit should have the same fanon. So let me conclude with some observations and open problems. So most lower bounds that we know of, you can reformulate them as being instantiations of this strategy with different geometric properties being used. I don't know if we can resolve VP versus VNP using this. There was a very interesting recent work by Oliveira, Vigdarsan, Ankit Garg, and Klim Efremenko, which showed some limitation of this technique, that as long as you're restricting yourself to linear maps, you cannot prove the extremely optimal lower bounds, the best possible lower bounds you cannot hope to prove. But there's a very wide range, and it does not rule out proving, let's say, n to the d by 5 kind of lower bounds via linear maps. So this the previous result that I mentioned, it implies that the depth reduction, the parallelization that you can do is optimal if you restrict yourself to homogeneous and regular formulas or homogeneous and regular circuits. Is this optimal? We don't know. We do know that if you allow non-homogeneity, you can do better. You can essentially knock off the 2 in the second exponent. You can make it 1 over delta rather than 2 over delta. The circuits that we get that way are extremely crazy. In between, you compute polynomials of extremely high degree. And we don't know what are the limits of parallelization. And so this is what we can show, that you can knock off the 2 to a 1. But we don't know if this is optimal or not. And there are a huge number of other geometric properties that one could potentially exploit to try to prove lower bounds. It seems that we have just gotten started. For example, the number of irreducible components of a variety, how many affine subspaces are there inside a variety, and so on. We don't understand whether these kind of geometric properties can be effectively exploited for lower bound purposes or not. Let me end here. Any questions?
So I want to see the hands. There's no question I can see. Then let
this one question.
So what do you mean by these almost orthogonal columns?
Yes. So the inner product of any two columns should be much smaller compared to their L2 norm. So let's say all the columns in my matrix have L2 norm 1. Then I want that the inner product of any two columns should have magnitude at most epsilon. And depending on epsilon, I will get a bound on the rank of the matrix. That's the nature of the result there. Yeah.
Hi. So is there anything like a monotone arithmetic circuit complexity?
Yes.
And can you, does this apply? Or wouldn't that be more, to work there first would it make more sense?
Yeah. The question is about monotone arithmetic circuits. They have been studied. So for example, over reals, you can define monotone circuits as allowing only addition and multiplication operations. So you are never allowed to use negative constants in the circuit. And what we know is that for monotone functions like the permanent, the best monotone circuit is has to be exponential size. And in fact, they match the monotone upper bounds as well. And you can have a notion of monotone circuits, in fact, for any field, a reasonable notion. And we do have very close to upper and matching upper and lower bounds over any field.
Okay, there's no more questions, so let's thank Neeraj and all the other speakers of today for their wonderful presentations and give them a big hand again.